Saints in Christ, Merry Christmas. Today, the text for our consideration is the Gospel according to St. Luke, that very familiar Christmas text, the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Hear now the Holy Gospel, as was inspired by the Holy Spirit, to be written by St. Luke. And it came to pass in those days, there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out to the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. So far the text. My question to you, why? Why did God our Father choose this time in history to send his Son incarnate in the flesh to be born in the manner in which he was born? Why did God choose that date? Only God knows for certain, but we theologians and historians can come up with some good possibilities on this. And I'm going to follow along with what Dr. Paul Meyer had to say about this. Let's look at the world at that time. The civilized world was the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire stretched from Britannia to the Persian Gulf, from England through Saudi Arabia. That was a big empire. They controlled all of that. And not only did they control it, they built roads. Many of those roads you can still find today. They're still there, made of stone. And it was safe to travel on those roads. There were soldiers stationed along the roads so that if you took off and went down the road to carry out business, that you had a caravan that you was going somewhere, you could rely upon the Roman government to have soldiers out there to protect the route. There was safety in travel. There was safety upon the sea also, the Mediterranean Sea. For you see, the Romans, they didn't mess around with criminals. They annihilated all the pirates, all those who would try to rob from ships. They got rid of them. So basically, the Mediterranean Sea was controlled by the Roman Navy, and commerce took place. Ships went back and forth all around the Mediterranean, carrying goods, carrying out trade. So you could get easily from one place to another by a road or by ship. Well, what are you going to do when you get there? Well, can you speak the language? At this time there was a common business language. Much as English is the business language of the world today, the business language at that time was Koine Greek. So, you have the Pax Romana, the peace of the Roman Empire, where you could travel about by road, by ship, you were guarded, you were protected, and where you went to carry on your business, there you could basically speak the language that was spoken all over. Where did Jesus set up his headquarters for his ministry? What town? Capernaum. Why? It's at the crossroads of many trade routes. People coming, people going. So, we think that God chose this time because it was an opportune time for the Word of God to go out throughout an entire empire easily in the language that was used by the entire empire, Koine Greek. And God uses other means for things. God uses pagans. He uses bad people to do things for him. I.e., in the reading, Caesar Augustus, a pagan Roman emperor. God used him to say there's going to be a census. And that census said that if you're born in Bethlehem, or your family history is from Bethlehem, you go back to Bethlehem to register and pay your taxes. So using the decree of a pagan emperor, God then enabled prophecy to be fulfilled that the Messiah would be born in the city of David, which is Bethlehem. And of course, if we look at the time date stamps that we kind of have here throughout Scripture, Meyer says that we can put Jesus' birth somewhere between 8 and 4 B.C. Luke continued, "And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." The Savior of the world is born. Did he come as a conquering king, as the Jews wanted? Did his mother wrap him in a nice Tyrian purple blanket and lay him in a cradle of solid gold? No. No. He came in the most simple of ways. His parents did not have a lot of money. We know that because when they went to take Jesus to the temple in 40 days, they could only afford a dove to make the sacrifice. They couldn't afford the lamb. She had swaddling clothes, simple cloths that she made, much as the same as all the poor people in that area made to wrap their babies after they were born. And his cradle, it was a feed trough filled with hay where she laid him. And of course, looking at this text, as we have talked about in Bible study, there's a lot more that we could talk about here. How many believe Jesus was born the night that they arrived in Bethlehem? Don't. He wasn't. What does Luke say? When the days were accomplished. So it didn't happen that very night. But we got to get everything condensed into an hour program, right? Yeah, that's why we put it all together. And there was no room for them in the inn. Is the innkeeper the villain? We got two different ideas here. The inn they're talking about here is the guest room in a house. It's not a hotel. So when Mary and Joseph arrived, Joseph, being from that area, had all kinds of relatives there, and they went and stayed with one of the relatives, and Mary gave birth to Jesus in that relative's home on the main floor of the home, because on the lowest floor is where the animals were kept. So if you had animals, you had feed troughs filled with hay to feed them. He was born in the house. She laid him in that feed trough. He came in the most simplest of ways. Luke continued, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said to them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign to you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." An angel appeared to some shepherds out in the field. Again, the angel didn't go to see King Herod. The angel didn't go see Caesar. The angel didn't go and talk to the governor. The angel was sent as God's messenger to those who were on the lowest rung of the vocational ladder at that time, shepherds. And the angel came to him, to them. What's the first thing he said? Fear not. When you think of an angel, do you think of that cute little thing you got sitting on your shelf at home? Or the little cherub maybe out in a garden or out in your yard? Or maybe we could think of the movie A Wonderful Life and think of when we die, we become angels, but we got to do something good and get our wings, right? All that is wrong. Angels are mighty, powerful beings. They are messengers of God. In Hebrew, it's called malak. In Greek, it's anglios. God says, you go and tell. And that's what they did. The angel went, this powerful being, and told the shepherds. And so if you're out there in the middle of the night, and all at once the sky is lit up, and there's this powerful being there, would you be afraid? I know I would be. I would be. And this fear continues today, does it not? I think so. The fear of God continues today in our world. People are afraid of God the Father because they know they are unrepentant sinners, that they are denying Christ as their Lord and Savior, that they are living a lifestyle that is immoral and impure, and so they're afraid. And not only that, they are so secularized, they hate Christians. And Christmas is nothing more than a time of partying and revelry and handing out of gifts. This morning, I get on my computer and I bring up the internet and I like to look at the news. One news site I go to is the British Broadcasting Corporation because they really got a lot of news on there about what's going on in the world. The biggest news agency in the world had nothing, nothing about Christmas. I went to Europe, nothing. I went to the Middle East, where they usually have a big celebration and they talk about Jesus being born. There was nothing. Why? Because unbelievers hate Christians and they are afraid of God. We don't fear, do we? We have no fear because we know that Jesus came for us, that Jesus died for us, that he came to bring peace between us and God the Father. For next thing that happened was this huge heavenly host began singing, glory to God in the highest and peace on earth. Is there peace on our earth today? Secondly, no. Is there peace on earth for all of us today? Yes. Because we baptized Christians know that Jesus came, Jesus died for us, Jesus redeemed us from our sin and made peace between us and our Heavenly Father. That is the peace that the heavenly host sang about. Luke continued. And it came to pass as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is to come to pass, which the Lord hath made known to us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. All that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all of these things and pondered them in their heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had seen and heard, as it was told unto them. Again, God goes to the lowliest. They come to that little house in Bethlehem. There they see a young mother who wrapped her newborn child in swaddling clothes the same way that their wives do for their babies. They were Jews. They knew that the Messiah was coming. They knew the prophecy. And there he was before them. God chose them to hear the good news of salvation, that the Messiah had arrived. So what did they do? They went out and they proclaimed that good news and told all kinds of people, whoever they came across, what they saw, what they heard. And here now we have this young woman, somewhere around 15 years of age. She knows that the baby that she is holding, the baby that she is nursing, is the very Son of God. She is Theotokos, the Mother of God. The awe and the wonder that filled her are beyond our imagination. So again I say, Merry Christmas. Our Savior is born. Advent is over. He has come. He is here. He is with us. He has brought salvation unto us. He has brought peace to earth because he has redeemed us from our sin so that our Father's wrath against us is now gone. We sing glory in excelsis. We sing joy to the world. The Lord has come. Let earth receive its King. Every heart, prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing. In the name of Jesus, amen. Please rise for the offertory.